Welcome back to another episode of Unpeeled. I'm Walker Simmons.
And I'm Mia MacGregor. Let's jump right into our top story.
Well, they're here, they're there, and now they're everywhere. Welcome back to another episode of Unpeeled. I'm Walker Simmons.
And I'm Mia MacGregor. Let's jump right into our top story.
All right, well, they're here, they're there, and now they're everywhere, including FIFA. Earlier today, EA Sports announced that AFC Richmond and the cast of Ted Lasso will be included in FIFA 23. The fictional team is said to be playable in career mode, kickoff, and online.
The game is set to drop September 30th, and fans of both FIFA and Ted Lasso were excited across social media about the announcement. Now, Coach Lasso, played by Jason Sudeikis, said that this is, quote, truly a dream come true for himself and the rest of the cast of Ted Lasso.
And now moving over to the tennis courts, Roger Federer announced his retirement on Thursday after over 24 years in the game. His career was marked by 20 Grand Slam titles that proved him undeniable. Federer leaves the sport with one of the best records in tennis history.
And Federer's announcement comes just a week after Serena Williams played in her final U.S. Open with the retirement of two of tennis's greatest stars and 19-year-old Carlos Alcaraz's win at the U.S. Open. A generational shift could be coming in the game.
Yeah, I mean, it feels like the end of an era here. First we have Williams, now Federer. I mean, really just a turn of a page.
No, it really does. And although it's sad to see them go, I feel like their legacy will carry on, you know, far beyond the game of tennis. I mean, Williams inspired future generations not only with her incredible athletic ability, but also with her journey as a black woman in a historically white sport.
Yeah, no kidding. Especially when you see legends like this step down, you start to see how much the community misses them and how much of an impact they have. Federer, for example, I mean, he had heartfelt tributes that came after his announcement of retirement, both from his supporters and his rivals. I mean, it's clear to say that he made a significant impact on the community.
Definitely. I totally agree. And, you know, speaking of losing legends, we now move from the green courts of tennis to the Broadway stage. Phantom of the Opera announced Friday that it would be closing its doors for good in 2023. The musical is the longest-running show on Broadway and will celebrate its 35th anniversary in January.
Yeah, and sales skyrocketed after the announcement, and the production sold $2 million worth of tickets by the end of that day. Fans will still be able to watch the international versions of the musical in London and other theaters around the world. Phantom of the Opera, though, will have its final Broadway show February 18th at the Majestic Theater.
You know, Walker, although all good things must come to an end, this one was particularly bittersweet for me. I mean, Phantom was the first Broadway show that I ever saw, so I am definitely glad that I had the opportunity to see it before it closed.
Yeah, and I unfortunately never got the chance to see it. I did get the chance to see Dear Evan Hansen, which ended last weekend.
Don't remind me. I mean, with Phantom announcing the end of its 35-year run, Dear Evan Hansen closing last weekend, I feel like Broadway is taking a really tough loss. But it does make me hopeful for new shows that are coming to the stage soon.
Yeah, no kidding. I mean, just kind of losing all these shows, it does open a lot of doors for some great Broadway shows entering in. Now, one thing I did hear, did you hear about this? They're creating a petition in order to get the show back. So people are that upset. They're taking a step forward.
Honestly, that's good. I mean, part of me wants to see it stay, but also it's time to see some new content. And Lea Michele and Funny Girl, I know that we covered
that last week,
but oh my gosh, that is something on my top 10 list of Broadway shows to see.
Mm-hmm. And it really kind of shows people hate to see good things go.
Definitely.
Well, hey, one of the biggest music events of the school year happened this weekend, and students had plenty to say about it. Our Syracuse events reporter, Tegan Brown, has more on Juice Jam.
Well, Walker and Mia, Juice Jam was a bit crazy this weekend. There were hundreds and hundreds of students there. A lot of them were freshmen, and actually talking to them, a lot of them said that they felt this was just kind of a freshman-oriented thing, but there were a ton of upperclassmen who were all pretty excited about that lineup, of course, consisting of Young Gravy, Dochi, Flo Milli, and T-Pain. And in case you didn't know, all of those artists are rap artists, but this University Union-sponsored event did draw a lot of reactions from students, and here are just a few that I gauged from them.
That's really cool that we have enough connection to get big artists like that to come here. I grew up loving concerts, so having the ability to see them, not only for Juice Jam, but also for Block Party, is very exciting.
If it was just Gravy alone, I'd still be here, but I'm excited for the other acts as well. Should be good.
T-Pain is a music revolutionary. A lot of the hip-hop and R&B music that we listen to today would not exist without T-Pain, because he revolutionized the use of auto-tune.
I just think it's such a random T-Pain, like, it's so random.
A Gravy Train, maybe Ash and Ray's mom's make an appearance. Had to rep the shirt for him, so.
Now, of course, you heard that last student there talk about Addison Rae's mom with Young Gravy being there and everything. And something I noticed among a lot of the students was the shirts that they were wearing saying things like, I heart hot moms, things like that. So, of course, I had to walk up to him, talk to him, interview him a little bit. But, hey, Juice Jam is not the only big music event that University Union runs each year. They also have Block Party, which will be in the spring. They usually announce that lineup sometime at the end of April. But, of course, here on Unpeeled, we will totally bring you all the latest coverage about who's going to perform, when, and what the lineup is going to be like. Guys, back to you.
Thank you so much, Tegan. When we come back, I got an exclusive interview with one of Juice Jam's hottest artists.
And you guessed it, even more Juice Jam breakdowns. We'll be right back on Peelers.
Your girls have been with you through every moment of your life. They were with you when you felt unbreakable. With you that time you felt most alone. And with you when you realized you would never be. They were with you when you shared your love with the world. And with you when she became your world. Your girls have never left you. They're still with you right now. But how well do you know them?
You don't know mine.
Knowing your breasts can save your life.
Welcome back. So anyone who knows me knows that I have been a huge fan of Young Gravy since he first started releasing music on SoundCloud. I had the opportunity to sit down with him after his performance at Juice Jam for an exclusive interview. Check it out.
Young Gravy in the building. Backstage, Juice Jam.
Most of your music, just getting back to your content, is very sample heavy, with a lot of those samples blowing up on TikTok recently. So I want to know, where does the inspiration for these samples come from? You know, do you choose the sample and then write the song based off of it, or do you write the lyrics and then choose what samples you're going to put into the song afterwards?
Sampling almost always comes first. I mean, sometimes we'll have a beat and like you can add some on top of it, but like you couldn't really make a beat and then put the sample on. The inspiration comes from just all my favorite music growing up. I mean, my favorite genre pretty much is like Motown and soul. So that's what I listen to the most. But like I make rap, I can't really sing, so I couldn't just switch. So I just bring that. I bring my music I like into the genre I make.
Good to know. And I've heard you talk, you know, in previous interviews about not wanting to reach the level of fame where you can't step outside and not have someone recognize you, right? So I want to know, given all of the success of Betty and, you know, kind of the newfound stardom that it's brought you, how have you been handling that?
It got to that point for sure. It doesn't help that I'm really tall and I can't really put on like a disguise or anything. So like here, cities like Syracuse is where, it's like if it's a town with a lot of young people and it's not a big city where they're like, if you're in like a New York City or something, people are gonna be like, oh, that's not Young Gravy, it's just a guy who looks like him. But if you're here, it's like, oh, you know, people get hyped. So like last night I probably took like 50 pictures. Yeah. When I went, I literally was like going to a studio and then a pizza store. So it sounds like this, yeah, it'll be a lot, but it's okay. People are usually really nice.
Yeah, definitely. Well, I'm glad to hear that you're handling that well. And those are all the questions that I had for you today, but I just wanted to say thank you so much for meeting with me. Yeah. And again, I'm Mia MacGregor with CitrusTV.
Thank you. I'm Gravy, and thank you for being such a big fan. I appreciate y'all. CitrusTV.
And here to discuss with us more about all things Juice Jam are Unpeeled's music reporters, Alexa LaMalfa, and our Syracuse events reporter, Tegan Brown. Thank you guys so much for being here today. So, Tegan, how are students feeling about these big-time artists, you know, coming here specifically for Syracuse University?
So a lot of these students were really kind of excited and shocked that they have the opportunity to have these big names come to Syracuse. I mean, we just heard Young Gravy say he took, you know, 50 some pictures with people here. And a lot of these students were just excited that the fact that, you know, they pay to go to Syracuse, they take classes here, that, you know, the university is providing them this opportunity to see such big artists is just astounding to them.
I totally agree. I mean, it's crazy to see these names in our tiny little campus. But Alexa, I have a question for you now. So a lot of people have been buzzing about the lineup, especially because unlike past years, it was all rap artists. Now, were students happy about this?
So, as you said, in the past, the lineup has consisted of a lot of different artists from different genres, meaning that there's something for everybody. This year, it wasn't necessarily the case. I got the chance to talk with a lot of students, and they had a lot of mixed feelings. Basically, the overall consensus was they were really happy to see Young Gravy. Otherwise, if you're like me and you didn't know all the songs, it was kind of anticlimactic, if I'm being quite honest. The music was hype, it matched up with the crowd, but going forward, I think University Union should definitely get more artists to be more inclusive.
And honestly, that's something that I totally agree with. I didn't really think about the fact that it was all rap artists there, but that makes perfect sense. So now, which artist would you both like to see come to SU in the future? For, you know, this spring's block party or upcoming Juice Jams. Tegan, let's start with you.
Totally. So, you know, Alexa was just talking about the lack of variation in the, you know, genre of artists here. And personally, I'm a big country music fan. So I know there aren't a lot of those on campus, but Scotty McCreery, I feel like he's small enough but big enough of a name where he would totally have an impact.
I totally agree. And Alexa, you?
So I am a huge 5 Seconds of Summer fan. And unlike Tegan, I think that's a really unrealistic answer considering they're one of the biggest bands in the world. I think University Union has a big talent for getting artists that don't have a lot of fame, but not
honestly,
that case for them.
Nothing's impossible. You never know what could happen. So after the break, our industry reporter, Lucas Vogel, tells us all about Patagonia's eco-friendly initiative. Stay tuned on Peelers.
Thank you.
Thank you.
A new live-action Little Mermaid is coming to our screens in May 2023. And although many fans are excited for this new spin on a beloved classic, there have been controversial opinions on the casting. Here to break it down for us is our film reporter, Eli Kerness. Eli, over to you.
Thanks, Mia. Disney's live-action remake of The Little Mermaid has been dealing with controversy since the casting of singer Halle Bailey as Ariel. While Disney's remakes always receive criticism from nostalgic fans, the response this time is overtly racist, with all of the negativity aimed at the casting of an African-American actress. When the trailer released earlier this month, it was met with harsh criticism. On YouTube, it received 1.5 million dislikes, and the comment section was flooded with extreme talking points that claim to defend the original version of the film, but in reality are just discriminatory towards Bailey. In the face of this negativity, the starring actress is proud to represent young African-Americans through this role and believes that, quote, if she had that when she was younger, it would have changed her whole perspective on life. Since the controversy came to light, Bailey has been met with an outpour of support, with fans sending her the reactions of young African-American girls seeing her as Ariel. As seen on her Instagram, she is, quote, truly in awe and thanks fans for their support. Looking back to the original version of The Little Mermaid, Ariel's voice actress Jodie Benson supports Bailey and believes that factors like race, dialect, and size are not what matter. Instead, quote, the spirit of a character is what really matters. Response to this controversy has also been heard from public figures as well. The Daily Show host Trevor Noah spoke out on the show, telling the public to, quote, stop being ridiculous. He hopes that the scandal doesn't overshadow the rest of the film. Despite the controversy, here at Unpeeled, we're very excited to see this film when it releases in May of 2023. Back to you guys.
Eli, thank you. Now, one of the largest outdoor clothing brands has just made a massive decision to sell their company to a nonprofit with the intent to help combat climate change. Industry reporter Lucas Vogel is here to tell us all about the new changes. Lucas, how you doing?
I'm doing well. I'm excited. Are you a Patagonia fan?
I am a Patagonia fan.
I am when I find some extra $1,000 in my bank account. It's expensive, isn't it?
Well, it is. And the founder of Patagonia recently made the decision to put his $3 billion where his mouth is. Was this a surprising decision?
Well, whenever $3 billion moves at the snap of a finger, I feel like you have to be a little surprised. But at the end of the day, I don't find it that surprising. And that's because Yvonne Chouinard, the founder of the company, has always kind of had that idea of climate change, of making sure that the planet is a reusable, sustainable resource. And at the end of the day, this is following what a lot of Scandinavian CEOs do. It's making sure that you have your inheritance not split up between a bunch of family members. It's making sure that your legacy is in one place. It's, you know, in a good place. People are always going to be looking at the Chouinard family in a positive light. And finally, before we get to the next question, Molly Kawahata, like you see on the screen, they've been doing a lot of different YouTube videos on her showcasing what she's done for the planet. She was on the White House climate change advisory staff under Obama. So this isn't anything new for Patagonia. So I was surprised, but I wasn't that surprised.
Yeah, and you mentioned it's making traction in the media. Do you think Patagonia is now going to be a trendsetter?
I think that Patagonia has always been a little bit of a trendsetter. I think when you think of those, like, quote-unquote visco girls that we all think of, Patagonia was really the first thing that looked good but also had, it was fashion and it was formal. So I think it was always a part of that, but now I think it's its own thing in terms of climate change setting the trend.
All right. Well, Lucas Vogel, as always, thank you. Unpeeled is bringing you the largest Bachelorette breakdown we have had yet. So much to unpeel with this crazy finale. We'll see you back after the break.
I never knew when I would have to move, so I always had my suitcase ready to go. Then one day, I was adopted. My new parents opened their hearts and home to me. My parents cook my favorite breakfast for me every morning. My parents take me on trips I never thought I would go on. They gave me a home and an even better reason to use that suitcase. My parents aren't perfect, but they're perfect for me.
Hey, Bobo, do trees tell each other stories?
I'm sorry, I'm afraid I don't know that.
Hey, why don't we go find out? Listen.
Do clouds take naps?
I couldn't tell you.
Dad, do stars visit their friends?
Look!
Jason, let's go see your room.
What do you think? We kept it a little spare, so you can decorate it how you like.
Dinner!
Here we go.
Excellent.
Suckers.
Yeah, I saw you guys out there.
We're the family.
Well, the season finale of The Bachelorette has finally come to an end, and the finale was full of twists, turns, and of course, heartbreaks. Well, we have a full panel of Unpeeled's Bachelorette experts here to break down everything that happened on the final episode. Lily, Charlie, Spencer, guys, thanks for being here.
Thanks for having us.
All right, so quick refresher here before we break down everything. Lily, what happened on the last episode?
Yeah, I think we all knew going into last night's episode that it was going to be one for the books. Lots of drama, lots of excitement going on. The women each entered this week, each having one man left. And I think even then, we all knew there was bound to be some drama. Rachel and Tino got in probably one of the biggest fights I've ever seen on Bachelorette history, and they ended up breaking up. Eric and Gabby, though, did get engaged, and the two have just been glowing ever since. So it was really nice to see a happily engaged couple come out of last night.
Wow, yeah, so twists and turns is definitely an understatement here. And Charlie, while Gabby and Eric got their happy ending, the same couldn't be said for Rachel. Well, I mean, what happened with Rachel?
Well, I knew something fishy was up the second that Tino proposed to Rachel, just because he proposed to her only 25 minutes into the 3-hour finale, leaving the rest of the show as a complete mystery. And that mystery turned into cheating and drama as it was revealed that Tino actually kissed a girl. He kissed a girl and he liked it, who wasn't Rachel, and she said, you know what, you're not getting any of this cherry chapstick, man. You're done, we're breaking up.
Aye, aye, aye. Spencer, it's great to see you back at the Bachelorette table.
Yeah.
I mean,
aye, 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 that's right.
Aye, aye, aye. Hey, so Gabby and Eric did end up engaged, but text from Eric's ex-girlfriend revealed that he did not show the skeptical. He was skeptical about finding love. I mean, what's Gabby's response to that?
All right, well, Eric wasn't nearly as blatant as Tino with the Katy Perry kissing another girl. But what saved this relationship was that Eric told Gabby months ago off camera that he had relations with this girl. Apparently, it was just a little bit about a month before the show started. He had been talking to this girl. It wasn't going to work out. But we've seen other engagements on the show end this way. We saw Hannah B. and Jed just a few years ago end their engagement because of some texts, some former relations. So things are looking good for now, but, you know, this show doesn't have a great track record right now.
Well, yeah, now this is where the knight in shining armor comes in with Avin. He showed up after Rachel and Tino got done hashing things out, and he swept her off the stage, you know, for the remaining of the episode. I mean, are the two going to get back together? Lily, let's start with you.
I am honestly so here for a Rachel and Avin reunion. I think the two of them had a really, really good connection, and I was honestly sad to see him go home when he did, simply because he wasn't quite ready for a proposal. I think Rachel made a bit of a hasty decision, and I think she realized that when Avin walked on stage. So she's really been put through the ringer this season. I think all of Bachelor Nation would love to see her get her happy ending, so I'm here for it.
I mean, just because Rachel's on ABC, that doesn't make her any different from either of us. We're all human. We all make mistakes, and she made a mistake, and now she's admitting it. So I'm happy to see them getting back together.
All right.
Make it a clean sweep. I'm going 3-0. I think her and Avin should be. I mean, come on.
I mean, come on. It's love.
Like Lily says, it was a hasty decision. You know, some say she overreacted a little bit. Who am I to say? We're not on ABC. We're on CitrusTV.
Final question here. Speed round now.
Uh-oh.
All right. I'll give you some time to think about this. All right, new Bachelor, all right? Who are we thinking? Who is this going to be? I mean, who do you expect at the end of the season?
Okay, I think we all know because we're huge Bachelorette fans. Yeah. We stayed up all night watching the episode. But we all know Zach is the new Bachelor. I got to say, I think it's kind of a basic choice. I don't know.
Agreed. I feel
like he didn't get a whole lot of airtime, and we don't really know exactly what his personality is like. So it definitely will be interesting to see how he handles his own season.
All right. Charlie, you were quiet. What do you?
Well, I mean, he's pretty mid, but I do love the play on word. I'm going to start calling it the Zatchler. Instead of Bachelor all season long. So yeah. I'm excited for that.
Okay.
Spencer? Yeah, this is a big two thumbs down. Nah, I'm not a big fan. You know, I'm going to start lobbying for the guy next to me. Oh. To be the Bachelor. Sorry, Walker, not you. Not you yet.
I don't know if that's how I want to make my TV debut.
No, it is. We're going Charlie for Bachelor.
Charlie for Bachelor.
Start the hashtag.
Charlie for Bachelor. So overall, good finale.
Yeah.
All right, well, hey, don't go anywhere on Peelers because Mia and I will be chatting about Hollywood's Baby Boom. We'll be right back in 2 minutes.
OTN is on all your favorite apps. Apple TV, Fire TV, and Roku. Search Orange Television Network or OTN. OTN has its best shows, short films, and CitrusTV on demand. Family and friends can watch OTN too. Watch the live stream of OTN to catch live Citrus TV news, live from Studio B, and mornings on the Hill. On or off campus, watch OTN anywhere.
Here's to the straggly ones. The first ones. But hey, I look good with this ones. The black, brown, red, and gray ones. The itchy ones. The ones grown by dad. Right. The ones grown for dad. The I nearly didn't do it this year ones. And the absolutely filthy ones. They all raise awareness, raise funds, start conversations, and save lives. Because whatever you grow will save a bro. Learn more at Movember.com.
And baby fever has hit Hollywood once again. Multiple celebrities have been sharing their baby news, giving fans excitement about their new mini celebrities.
From Trisha Paytas to Nick Cannon, Michelle Kwan, and more, Hollywood ranks are definitely growing. And of course, this is something that we have to talk about on Unpeeled.
Oh, I mean, we have to. So much happened.
So, you know, I'm super excited about all of the babies being born this week, you know, happy for their families, blah, blah, blah. But one baby in particular really stood out to me. Do you have any guess who I'm talking
about?
I do.
Malibu Barbie. First of all, when I heard about this, I was a little shocked. But then at the same time, I was like, kind of makes sense, you know.
You know, how did you guess? I would have thought that you had no idea. But, you know, with a name like that, the poor baby already has her cards stacked against her. But hopefully one day down the line, maybe she'll find herself a Malibu Ken?
Malibu Ken. I like that. That could work.
It would be a good idea for a doll. Start selling in stores.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. There you go.
Yeah.
Trademark. Well, I kind of feel bad for her kid, though. Like, she's going to have a hard time in school. I mean, the kids aren't going to have to worry about making up names for because her mom kind of already did that for her. And not to mention, let's look at Elon Musk. His kid was weird, but I think she might have topped this. She might have set the bar a little higher.
I mean, Malibu Barbie, a weird set of numbers. Anything is better than naming your kid after your husband's mistress.
But anyways, true.
I think that might be a whole nother episode of Unpeeled to even touch on that situation.
That is a whole other episode.
You know, as weird as it is, I'm not going to lie, it's expected from Trisha Paytas. I can't tell you that I would expect anything less, honestly.
One thing that the reason I was not very surprised was the whole social media buildup to it.
Oh, yeah.
With everything kind of her expecting, first of all, the queen's death thing.
Yeah. Well, anyways, Trisha Paytas.
Like I said, long story.
That's all the time we have for tonight. I'm Mia MacGregor.
And I'm Walker Simmons. Have a great night, Syracuse.